they split the bill. Take a deep breath and finally show a little respect for Canadians.
After the Minister of Finance gave a speech of less than 1 hour, the opposition, NDP, had their opportunity to begin debate. And what did they do? They had one of their critics filibuster for 3 full days. And that doesn't show a lot of respect for taxpayers.
Well, a showdown obviously looms, and MPs are bracing for what will be a marathon of votes in the House of Commons. Opposition parties are pulling out all the stops to delay the government's controversial omnibus budget implementation bill. They're tabling hundreds of amendments and motions to delete parts of that bill that will keep MPs voting for hours and hours and hours. Of course, the Conservatives have a majority in the House, which means the budget bill will ultimately pass. But will the government grow weary and give in to any of the changes? And is all this political maneuvering a legitimate exercise in parliamentary procedure to hold the government to account? Or is it a waste of time that will only delay the inevitable? And joining me now is the government House Leader, Peter Van Loan.
Nice good to be with you.
Okay, I got to start with this. This is your budget bill, the budget implementation bill. These are the deletions that they want in the amendments to it. They're almost the same size. Is there no room for compromise between what they want deleted in order to slow this process down and what you're offering?
Well, that actually accurately captures it, because really all that we're facing is an opposition that opposes the bill. They don't really want to seriously make any changes. There are no changes they've told me that we could make that would cause them to support the bill. So they're really just looking at ways of opposing it many times over. It's an important job creation bill, important for economic growth in this country, and that's our plan to proceed forward with it. I know in the case of the official opposition, they have a bit of a different job creation plan. The NDP leader wants us to send billions over to European banks to bail them out. That's his idea of how we can help the Canadian economy. This plan, our Economic Action Plan 2012, is our idea of how we can help create jobs and economic growth here in Canada.
But the reason I said slow it down, because that is what it has come down to. But you've heard over the past week from a number of different people who are concerned about some of the individual things that are contained in the budget implementation bill. For example, some former fisheries ministers about the Fisheries Act changes. What I'm trying to get some sense from you is I know you've called it a job plan, and that's clearly what it is, but why is there no room to take into some of the criticism that's been leveled? Let's start with the fisheries portion of it.
Well, the fisheries portion is a good example, because this is I think it was a well-intentioned provision when it was originally introduced, but as often happens, the unintended consequences are quite different, and what has happened is farmers looking to clean out drainage ditches get caught up by fisheries and oceans.
Was that preventing
simple
them from
infrastructure
creating jobs?
Projects? Oh. Well, yeah, you end up with projects. I had, for example, within my own riding, a very serious project involving in the Holland Marsh, digging out canals, relocating them, dealt with serious life safety issues. Cars were going into those canals. People were dying about every second year, someone was. And this got held up because at the very last hour, just before it was about to go forward, suddenly fisheries and oceans officials said, hold it. This artificial environment you've created that you're going to recreate as an artificial environment over here, I'm not so sure that's a fishery.
And that's the kind of
stuff that gets delayed. And again, you see this. You see a jamboree where you have a rainstorm beforehand. The fields get filled up with water. All of a sudden they say you can't have your concert because now that there's water in the fields, there might be fish.
Let me put the unintended consequence so to you is that the people who are criticizing some of these changes say the unintended consequences of designating some species as protectable and others not may have the unintended consequence of not being able to protect any of them.
No, that's not true at all. In fact, what it allows us to do is focus the protection in the right place and not get in the way unduly of creating unnecessary obstructions everywhere. I used to practice in this area of land development approvals, and I can tell you the fisheries and ocean stuff came up in the most unlikely of places. Here you are, you'd be 100, 200 kilometers away from any major body of water dealing with a plain field, and suddenly somebody says there's an issue. We've got to refocus the effort so that federal efforts to protect fisheries habitat are actually focused on real fisheries habitat. And at the same time, you allow jobs and economic growth to go forward in places where there is no impact.
Okay, so the jobs and economic growth is a priority. If this is going to be delayed, because there are 579, I think, different deletions and or amendments so far, Elizabeth May to weigh in, and we'll talk about her in a minute, why not just pull it for the time being and let the more important things go through or the things that you have to have go through and have some further study of?
Well, this is a comprehensive economic plan. We're looking at what we can do to make Canada succeed economically.
But it doesn't fall apart if you take out one section, does it?
Well, it's a comprehensive plan. It's reflected in our budget. It's a budget implementation bill. It implements the budget. That's why we're bringing it forward. It deals with ensuring that we have the most skilled workforce, which we have now, that it continues to stay such, and it's that into the future. We have measures in the bill to do that. It's to ensure that we balance our budget so we continue to have the strongest fiscal position of any of the major developed economies.
But my point is fish habitat, for
that's
example, is not
important.
Going to stop you from balancing the budget.
That's an important part of allowing infrastructure projects to go ahead. The Highway 407, for example, when it was extended most recently, that got delayed, again, because of one of those interventions under fisheries
notions. Highway north of Toronto and the GTA.
That's right, very important highway where, and that was years ago. I think the NDP may have been government in Ontario, or maybe it was after that, but it was like a long time ago. But it's an example of how these measures get in the way. So we have a comprehensive plan to create jobs. In the near term, in the long term, we have a job creation credit for small businesses. We want to move forward with it. The opposition parties aren't interested in breaking it up so they can support parts. No, they're still going to vote against all of them.
No, they were said to improve parts. But
but what they've always said is, in the end, we're still going to oppose it. So all they've come up with is a whole bunch of different ways to oppose our job creation plans. I mean, we at least have a plan.
So
Thomas Mulcair's only plan is to send billions to Europe to bail out Spanish and
Greek banks.
All right,
I know you said that. Let's leave that for the moment. The answer is no, for those of you who are keeping track. There is no willingness to debate, and that's fine. I want to look ahead. Next week, we have all of these deletions, plus Elizabeth May is coming. And the first point is that she wants the entire thing thrown out as not really being an omnibus bill. You oppose that? Speaker will rule on that first? Is that where we go?
Well, the Speaker will rule on what he rules on when he gets around to it. I don't know. That's up to him. But I can tell you, again, that's again another effort just simply to object to the bill. I don't think there's any merit in her arguments, but it shows that, again, the opposition is focused on every step possible they can use to delay and obstruct our job creation.
So how do you deal with
all
these things?
They don't have a plan for jobs. Okay.
How do you deal with all these things going forward then? I mean, we have all these amendments, all these deletions. Are you hoping they'll be grouped together? Is it your argument that they should be dealt with in one vote, two votes, or do you have to vote on all of them?
Well, the next step is for the Speaker to decide what is grouped into select items for voting. And if you actually read the standing orders, he's got broad powers to select what should be voted on, including if things are frivolous, vexatious, appear designed to create delay. He doesn't have to select them for a vote at all. In fact, that provision that's been added to the standing orders, this will be the first time it's been substantively interpreted. So I have every expectation that the Speaker will take seriously the direction of the House of Commons gave him when the Liberals introduced those changes to the standing orders and gave the Speaker the power to do that to prevent exactly these kinds of delay and obstruction situations.
So how long do you think it will take to get it through this final reading?
Well, we'll have to wait and see what the decisions are, but from the government side, our members are committed and determined to do what it takes to get this through. They're willing to work the hours necessary because the jobs and economic plan that's there is too important.
Peter Menlo, thanks for coming in.